Apparently, further east of us, they had a lot more snow than from here over. I can tell you out in Littleton, so when I saw the phone ringing after I'd gotten out of the showers getting ready, why is Cherry Creek Schools calling? Hello? Hello? The Cherry Creek Schools is on a snow day. Oh, sweet.
Like, that was kind of a snow day.
What snow day were you going to go out to this week?
Yeah.
They called it like a snow day thing.
Yeah, well, some they have some different schedules, so. But who knows?
Well, it was all right. We got an extra.
Yeah, we had a 10-day spring break. That was an all right gig. I'll take that any spring break, huh? So, good stuff. So we didn't really lose a whole lot of instruction because our Friday was actually a question mark of what should we do? Because we as the teachers didn't really know at that point. So, but here's the thing. We have 7 weeks left to the end.
Ooh.
7 weeks left until the end. Yes, we have.
We have 163 weeks until we graduate.
We have
163 what?
163 weeks until we graduate.
There you go.
Some of these people are going to be
home. So, we have 2 days that are goofy with testing. We have one this week on Wednesday and one next week that's goofy on testing. So, we have some weird stuff, but we got to finish strong. So, most of you are doing very, very well. So continue doing what you're doing. Don't let yourself fall behind. If you miss out on something, please make sure you watch the videos. Come talk to me. Ask me. Make sure I don't move forward. Because what we're going to get into is graphing of parabolas, which we've been solving them up to this point with factoring. Okay? So zero product property is what we're going to talk about today. So let's get these out to you. And take some notes and see what we can do. Zero product property is our latest gig, okay? This is, we are factoring something, and then we're setting whatever that little binomial comes out to, set it equal to zero. That's all it is. Everyone got one? Ready, set, go. There we go. Come on back. All right, so if x times y is equal to zero, where x and y are whatever or whatever you want it to be. What can you tell me about x or y right now?
Yeah.
Well, one negative, one positive being multiplied together would give us a negative answer. Both negative or both positive would give us either would give us a positive answer. What does x or y have to be?
Zero.
One of them has to be zero. They both can be zero, but at least one. Why do I say that? What property is taking place right here? It's multiplication. In order to multiply two things together for our answer to become equal to zero, at least one of them has to be zero. Okay? So let's see what we have here. We got something to pull. So, zero product property. If A, B equals zero, then either A equals zero or B equals zero or both. It doesn't matter. As long as one of them is zero, it doesn't matter what the other thing is. So, if I go zero times a quantity, I still get zero. Okay? If I'm going to distribute zero over the parentheses, my whole answer will be zero. So, that's key right there to recognizing that at least one of the terms has to be equal. that make sense?
Go catch.
Can I move forward? Good?
All right.
So, use the zero product property to find all possible values that make the product equal to zero. Be sure to explain the reasoning. So, can I turn this 5 right here into a 0? No, it's 5 is 5. It's just the numeric value 5. So what could I do to this to make that equivalent to 0? X is a variable. A variable is a value. What value does X have to be to make that middle part equal to 0? No, 0 minus 3 is negative 3.
Oh, 3.
3, right? So if I plug, if I put a 3 in right here, this would become 5, and then 3 minus 3 equals 0. What does this become then?
0.
And then 5 times 0 is obviously equal to 0. Okay? So that's how the zero property works, is you say, okay, what value could I plug in that's going to make this 0? And in this case, we plug 3 into our answer, we'd get, and again, we're plugging into a variable. What about the second problem? There's two different numbers that could work. I have a variable out front, x, and then I have a binomial of x plus 5. So what do you think?
Can you use 0 if you're just
remembering? Yep, I could use 0 right there. What does this have to be?
Negative 5.
So 0 and negative 5. If I plug those in, the answer becomes 0. Okay, yeah.
Wait, for the second x value, it has to be negative 5 because either way.
Because negative 5 plus 5 is?
0. But either way, you're distributing 0 to both.
Right. So if this is 0 here, right. If I make that a 0, 0 times is 0. Or if I make that negative 5, that becomes 0.
Oh, okay. I see. Never mind.
So.
Even if it's like negative 7 or negative 2, that's still 0.
No, it isn't.
Right.
If I plug negative 7 and I get negative 7, negative 7 plus 5.
No, I'm saying the second x. If the first x is 0, then the
next. Oh, yeah. Yeah. Well, and the thing is, x is a variable, so as long as it's. If I plug 0 in here, 0 would actually go in there, too.
Thanks, Chris.
Yeah. Let's take a look at number 3. I have 3 different locations I have an x. So the first x, I can make all the x's 0. If I make that 0, I get 0 minus 4, which is negative 4. 0 plus 1, which is 1. 0 times anything is going to be
0.
So if I had a 0, that's going to happen. What would make this part right here 0? What number do I plug? Negative 1. What makes this 0?
Positive
4. So if I plug 0, negative 1, or 4 into this problem, I'm going to get, because we're multiplying those all together, it's going to become equal to 0. Problem number 4 looks similar to problem number 1. I have a constant term as a 6 out front. So I can't change the 6 to a 0 because there's not a letter to substitute in. But what could I plug in here that's going to make that 0?
2.
So 2 minus 2 is 0. 0 times 6 is 0. That seem to make sense? So you're trying to take one of your terms, and it could be a whole string of things. But this goes along the joke. You might have heard this as a child, and you thought you were a genius when you heard it, and you played it on your parents, and your parents couldn't figure it out. But if you were to take all of the hair on people's head in the world and multiply it together, what do you get? 0. Why 0? Because there's at least one person out there completely bald. Right? You have one person who has no hair. So you're like, yeah, but, you know, Mr. Stripp, you don't have as much hair as me. I gotcha. And even if we took all the hair I have, which is not that much, and all the hair that you all have, which is a whole lot, and multiply together, it becomes a big number. But if you found somebody who was bald and had no hair on their head, I would multiply times 0, and it would just cancel the whole thing out to be 0. So it's that little riddle that you can catch people on. Okay, and I know it's goofy and it's a silly analogy, but hey, go with it. It's a Monday after break. I'm trying. Number five looks a little different. We have variables on both, right? We have an X on both. Yeah, we have numbers in front of it. So we have to figure out what's going to make it zero. So some people might say, oh, well, I'll just plug zero in. Well, four times zero is indeed zero. But what's zero minus three? Negative three. Oh, okay, well, it'll work over here. So the two times zero is zero. Zero added to nine is?
Nine.
So does zero work? Okay, well, maybe if I just plug one in. Okay, if I plug one in, four times one is four. Four minus three is? Oh, maybe you work here. 2 times 1 is 2. 2 plus 9 is 11. That didn't work. Gosh, what do you think I should do to
multiply the variables
together? Multiply the whole thing out? Okay. I guess I could do that. If I do multiply the whole thing out, I would wind up with 8x squared
minus
6x plus 36x. Minus 27, so that minus 27 is going to goof things up as well. So let's see. What if I did this? 4x minus 3 and set it equal to 0. Let's go back to first semester of Algebra 1. How do I solve this?
Add 3.
Absolutely. Add 3. Everyone agree? What's the last step?
Divide
by 4. So x is equal to 3 over 4. So that means if I were to take 3 over 4 and plug it in here, if I plugged 3 over 4 into that, 4 times 3 fourths is 3. 12 fourths, which is 3. 3 minus 3 is?
0.
That's going to work. What do you think I should do with the second one to figure out the other value? So if I plug 3 fourths in here, it's not going to be 0 here. But if I do 2x plus 9 and set it equal to 0, and again, first semester of Algebra 1, subtract 9, divide by 2. If I were to take negative 9 over 2 and plug it in right there, I get 2 times the quantity 9 over 2. So it becomes negative 9. Negative 9 plus 9 is 0. So if I plug either 3 over 4 in or I plug negative 9 over 2 in, one of those values becomes equal to 0, which means the whole thing is 0. So those are actually solutions to the problem. May I move forward? See if we can clear this up a little bit more. Okay, so recall the value of the function is its y value. The x-intercept is the zero of the function. So the x-intercept is the zero of the function. So right here, the x-intercept is the zero of the function. So if I were to go and figure out what this, and I just count over, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. If I were to take 6 and plug it back into my answer, I would get 0. I think we can clear that up a smidge more as we go forward. Okay? The fundamental theorem of algebra. Woo! We hit it on a Monday after break. The fundamental theorem of algebra states that each polynomial with complex coefficients, there are as many roots as the degree of the polynomial. What in the heck does that mean? Hang on, let's break that up. The fundamental theorem of algebra states that for each polynomial with complex coefficients, there are as many roots as the degree. Okay? So, let's say I had x plus 4, y equals x plus 4. It's a linear equation. Okay? So, I have 1, 2, 3, 4. What makes this 0? What number do I plug in? X is a negative 4. If I plug negative 4 in, I get where it crosses the x-axis. That's a root. That's a 0. Okay?
Let's say I had something like this, x plus 2, x minus 3, and let's set y equal to it. What value do I plug in right here that gives us 0? Negative 2. Negative 1, negative 2. What value do I plug in here that gives us a 0?
3.
Positive 3. 1, 2, 3. Okay. If I were to graph this, these are the two spots that this graph is going to have in common. And what's going to happen is this is going to either do this, or it could go upside down. We're not there yet, but right now that's what our graph's going to do. This graph just did this. Just was a straight line. Now I'm making it dotted, not because we're doing an inequality, just to show that we're not quite there yet. So if I multiplied this out, if I multiplied this out, FOIL'd it, what's my highest degree it becomes? X squared. Plus whatever else. X squared, you see this 2? That means that it's going to have two solutions. This is x to what power? What power is this?
First power.
First power, which means I have a single solution. So let's say we had x to the fifth. Five solutions. Now, the solution means it could cross the x-axis 5 different times. It doesn't have to. It just means that there's 5 different things that could be plugged in that makes your answer 0. Okay? So x to the fifth, I mean, I have no idea what the function would be, but I mean, this could be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and that means this graph could look like this. Something like that. Okay? It doesn't have to be identical to that. It's just that's one possibility the graph could look like. Ron, you have a question? Oh, yeah. Yeah. You're not going to see that in this, but yeah. Any shape that you generate, there's some sort of sequence of events that could create that. Okay. It doesn't always have to take place on an XY Cartesian or XY coordinate plane. There's, well, you have one of the fancy calculators. If you get to the mode, there's polar, parametric, rectangular. We're in rectangular, which means an xy-axis. But there's other things that you can do. All the graphing we're doing is, right now, is in something called Euclidean geometry, which means you can draw it on a flat surface. But you can start getting to math that takes place on not flat surfaces. You could do, you could work with things that are on a sphere, which would be a ball. Things like that. And there's all, the rules change depending upon what surface you're using the map on, which is then where it starts going into how, if you want to go really beyond, it goes on, you know, one of the things that's taking place now is how could we travel far distances in outer space with a limited amount of resources, and there's certain things that you have to think mathematically can be done. There's a, have any of you seen the movie, it just came out, Hidden Figures? You know the movie I'm talking about? It's a great movie. It's a great movie. And it's about when we were, it was about the space race here in the United States. And you did, you know, the nice, the thing about it was, the people who were the Hidden Figures was, it was a large amount of African-American females that were working on the space program that were ignored. They were very valuable, but they were ignored because it took place during a, you know, pretty dark time of United States history. It absolutely amazes me that we got as far as we got with the prejudices that we as a nation had and sometimes still have, and it's unfortunate. But they were talking about you... The main point was, if you were to put, if you had Earth like this, and you had something in an elliptical orbit around the Earth, how would you figure out how to bring them back down to Earth? So you're taking an ellipse and a parabola, and you're figuring out, okay, this is where something would have to take place, and then this would have to be the path down to where they would land. That was the big problem we were having, because this was something that had not mathematically taken place, but because of the nature of how space flight happened, we could put a person into outer space without a problem. It was, how do we bring them back down? And it was using the math. So it was using, this is a parabola, which is what we're going to be talking about. An ellipse is a circle that you kind of pull. You have a major and minor axis on it. But that's the math that takes place. Here's the concept of what they were doing. What they had done is they had this huge chalkboard that they were writing these equations on. And it was fantastic math. It wasn't the most difficult math, but it was putting two different types of mathematics together in order to figure out a solution. And the solution obviously worked. Though we've had astronauts die on their way and die once they've entered the atmosphere, we had nobody die in outer space, fortunately for us. But that's the math that was taking place. But good stuff. All right, so let's apply the fundamental theorem of algebra to determine how many possible roots. So a root means, where is it going to cross the x-axis or make our answer equal to zero? Okay? And the reason I have to put the disclaimer of both is you were told up to a certain point, if you had the square root of a negative answer, you know, you might have put DNE for does not exist. Well, it does exist, but it's a different type of math called complex mathematics. It does exist. But let's start applying this. So the very first problem, how many places do you think it could cross the x-axis? The x-axis is the horizontal. One, okay, because this is x to the first power. How can I figure out where this crosses the x-axis? I can go ahead and solve it. Okay, subtract 15, divide each side by negative 2, so I get 15 over 2, which is 7.5. I can learn how to write again. Okay, so at 7.5, so this on an xy axis, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and 8, right here is where it would have crossed. Okay? What about this one? How many possible solutions do you feel it might have? Two. It's raised to the second power. What about this one? Three. My highest exponent's that. So that's three solutions. What about this last one? One. Why one?
Negative and positive.
Yeah, these cancel each other out. They are opposite terms. So this means it's going to cross one time the x-axis, so similar to what's over there. This crosses twice, three times, because the highest exponent is 3. So the fundamental theorem of algebra, if you had x raised to the 10,000 power, your graph could cross the x-axis 10,000 times. That, the reality of it is, it's not as real as you would think, but in theory, that could indeed happen. What about this one? I don't have an x. The x isn't there. So x raised to what power could I plug in here? X to the first is x. But how could I write this 5x to some power? To the 0. X to the 0 power is 1. So if I made that 0, that would become 5. X to the 0 is 1. So it goes back to 5. So what does that mean? Does it cross the x-axis?
No.
What kind of line is y equals 5? I know it's straight, but what kind of straight line? It's a horizontal straight line, right? So if you think about what this looks like, y equals 5, you go up 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, you here's my line. It's a horizontal line. It doesn't cross the x-axis. Therefore, it doesn't have a root that is there. So this is a little different math that's taking place sometimes. Zero product property. What could you plug in for the variable that makes it zero? Yeah.
Would you normally have to show work for that?
No, you don't have to. I'm just trying to show, here's the math that's taking place. Yep.
So, with like, on the theorem, with h at t is equal to 6 minus 2x squared minus 4x squared to the 3, if we find the solution and plug it in for x, would we keep the cube root derivative?
No. That's, oh man, that's such a great question. That's something you're going to have to save until you take algebra 2. They have some great math that works for this. One's called Descartes' rule of sines, and you figure out the roots. You use something called synthetic division, which is pretty cool. Doesn't look like the division you learned how to do in elementary school, but it works really well. And then you get mad because you're like, oh, why? They could have taught me this heavy division. I would have gotten division right away. We should wait until algebra 2 for you to see. But that's a great question. So it does start breaking down. Something like this could break down to a whole bunch of binomials all on a string. Okay. Apply the fundamental theorem of algebra to determine how many roots. Okay. Remember, root is crossing. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. What power do you think this would be? X to the fifth. I don't know what the rest of the equation is, but it's like that. What about this one? It crosses 1, 2, 3, 4. What do you think it's at?
X to the fourth.
X to the fourth. Am I worried about where it's crossing the y-axis in this game?
No.
No. I'm using where it crosses the x-axis to determine what exponent it'd be up to. Yeah?
I'm sorry, I have a question on the last slide.
Yeah?
So do you have to solve all the
So this is just, like this one here is, it's further math just for you to recognize that it could happen three times. So this one could be 1, 2, 3, so it could look something like this.
So we don't solve them.
We're not solving at this point, no. We're just recognizing if it's raised to an exponent, the highest exponent could tell you how many times it could cross the x-axis. What's the key word I'm using there?
Could.
Will isn't the word that you're using. It could take place a number of times. And we're going to learn this, that we have some that you would think are going to cross twice, but they actually bounce off it. Okay, they bounce from the top or they bounce from the bottom. But we'll get there in a little bit. All right, we okay with these? X to the fifth because it crosses five times. X to the fourth because it crosses four times. All right, so in the following polynomials, let's factor it completely, and then we want to use the zero product property to find the roots. Okay, so we're going back to factoring. Now, I know that it's been 10 days, 11 days since we factored, so let's kind of do a refresher. My magic number is what?
Negative
12. So I know that both my signs are going to be plus, plus, minus, minus, or one of each. One of each. Everyone still with me in this? And again, we're reviewing a little bit. The factors of 12 are 1 and 12, 2 and 6, 3 and 4. Which of those factors would work? 1 being positive, 1 being negative. That would add up to the positive 4. 2 and 6 indeed does work. Which one has to be positive to give me a positive 4? So positive 6, negative 2. Everyone still with me? All right, so let's break it up. X squared minus 2x. Plus 6x minus 12. Let's review real quick. Could I add plus 6x here and minus 2x here? Yeah, as long as the signs are appropriate. What was the next step here? What did we have to do? I forget. Yeah, I look for each pair and I factor a greatest common factor. What's my greatest common factor there? X, so that leaves me x minus 2. Agree? What's my greatest common factor here? 6, and it's positive 6, right? Now what? What's my answer going to come out to?
X plus 6 and X minus 2?
Cool. Now we're going to set up my zero product property. What would make that zero?
Negative 6.
So if I went x plus 6 equals 0, if I subtract 6, I find that x equals negative 6. If x equals negative 6, I get 0 here. I get negative 8 over here, right? But 0 times negative 8 is?
0.
And then over here, looks like if I go x minus 2 equals 0, so x equals 2. So let's take a look here. If I plug 2 in here, I get 2 plus 6, which is 8. And then 2 minus 2 is 0. 8 times 0 is 0. So look at this. That's my zero product property. Those are the two places that our answer would cross the x-axis. Problem number 2, some things, just using the terminology we know. How many solutions, or how many roots, or how many times does it cross the x-axis? 3. Why is it 3? The highest exponent is to the third power. So it could cross the x-axis 3 times. Let's see if we can factor this out. So do we have a greatest common factor on all three terms?
2x.
Anything better?
4x?
I like 4x better. So let's see, if I factor a 4x out, if I factor a 4x out of 4x to the third, what do I have left? If I factor 4x, is x squared, good. If I factor a 4x out of 8x squared, I have what left?
2x,
good. And if I factor a 4x out of negative 12,
negative 3,
awesome. This is going to come down here, and we're going to figure out what goes there. So now we need to factor this. What's my magic number?
Negative 3.
Okay? If it's negative 3, what do you know about our two signs? One's positive, one's negative. So my factors of 3 are 1 and 3. Is there some way that I could make 1 and 3 happen, 1 being positive, 1 being negative, to give me an answer?
Yes.
So positive 3 and? Everyone agree?
Yes.
So positive 3 times negative, or plus negative 1 is positive 2. All right, so we're just factoring this right here is all we're doing. Remember, this has already come down here, so I'm not worried about it. So I'm going to get x squared minus 1x plus 3x minus 3. Remember, if I put those back together, I'd get the positive 2x. Agree? All right, so we're looking at the pairs. What do I have in common here? X, and then x minus 1, right? What do I have in common here? And it's positive 3, right? So what goes down here? X and plus 3. All right. So remember in the beginning we said this could have 3 solutions. It could cross the x-axis 3 times. Okay? So let's look at this first one. What do I plug in for x to get 0? Yeah. So 4x equals 0, so x equals 0. Okay? So that's the origin, 0, 0, right? Now let's take a look. If I plug 0 in here, I get 4 times 0, that's 0, negative 1, and 3. 0 times negative 1 times 3 is 0. It works. Okay, what about this one? I get x minus 1 equals 0, so x equals positive 1. Now let's take a look. If I plug positive 1, I get 4 times 1, which is 4. 1 minus 1 is 0. 1 plus 3 is 4. 4 times 0 times 4, 0. That worked. And then take my last one. X plus 3 equals 0, so I get x equals negative 3. Okay? If I plug negative 3 in for x, I get 4 times negative 3, which is negative 12. That's not 0. And then I get negative 3 minus 1, which is negative 4. That's not 0. And then I get negative 3 plus 3, which is 0. So this number times 0 is 0. So mathematically, this problem would cross here at 0, cross at 1, and cross at negative 3. So this could look like this as a graph. Again, I'm not worried about where it's crossing the y-axis at this point. And again, that's what this graph could look like. Does it look exactly like that? No, we're just putting a little bit of visual in. Our fundamental theorem of algebra says If it's raised to the third power, you could have these three solutions. Yeah.
So if it was only raised to the first power, would it be a straight line?
Be a straight line, uh-huh. Yep. Well, that's a big leap right there. Okay, first power linear, second power quadratic or parabola. Third power is a trinomial. So it crosses three times. Sweet. Oh, you guys are so smart. I love you guys. Okay. Is that it? You kidding me? That's it? All right. Let's see. So, our assignment, and we're going to have about 15 minutes to start it, and I would strongly urge you to start it. Has some factoring review. Okay, so it's going to be page 63-64. As far as the worksheet goes. Let's see where we're at. Zero product property, perfect. Factoring. It looks like Friday I will have a take-home test for you. And then a week from the day, we'll actually have our test on this chapter. So this whole week, we're just finishing up the factoring and solving by factoring. And then we'll go with a test on it. Pretty cool? I think we'll be all right.